I was strolling on the moon one day in a merry, merry month of December.
Now, May.
May. When, much to my surprise, a pair of bunny eyes.
I therefore ask the Congress, above and beyond the increases I have earlier requested for space activities, to provide the funds which are needed to meet the following national goals. First, I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space, and none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish.
But if I were to say, my fellow citizens, that we shall send to the moon, 240,000 miles away, a giant rocket more than 300 feet tall, and do all this and do it right, and do it first, before this decade is out, then we must be bold.
I just can't tell you how proud we all are of what you have done. For every American, this has to be the proudest day of our lives. And for people all over the world, I am sure that they too join with Americans in recognizing what an immense feat this is.
Tonight at 9:53 local time, Apollo 17 lifts off for the moon, and the dream ends. Not just the dream of exploring the moon, but the dream that perhaps, in our lifetimes, we would see mankind begin the greatest journey in history, the journey out there to the stars. A few brief years ago, it seemed that nothing would stop that journey beginning, and that we would be the first generation to live in the space age. To be sure, lunar exploration was to become perhaps a little unspectacular for some people, but then the moon was only to be the first step. Now it looks like being the last, for one fundamental reason. In the intervening years, since the excitement of the very first blast off those years ago, America has changed radically.
Well, I've always thought that in the face of the poverty in this world, that space programs are real fine things for the future, but we have an awful lot to do on Earth here before we start getting involved with hundreds of billions of dollars for space programs.
I think they could use the time, the energy, and the money to better advantage here in the United States. There's lots of room for improvement here.
Rather than spend all that money exploring space when people are starving here, and that money could be put to very good use in improving life here.
Sure, like, it's fun to find out what's going on up there, but it's really not that important to the survival, not right now.
I think that we are spending too much money and money, and that they are so much hungry here in the Earth.
You know, there's a state of apathy in the United States now, I guess. People just don't care one way or another.
At one time, back in 1969, after the first landing, the National Academy of Sciences was calling for no less than 15 lunar landing missions at a cost of around $10 billion. Today we've had seven, there are no more, and the budget is down around $3.5 billion. All we can look forward to is an orbiting laboratory, a slight increase in the satellite program, and a short joint Russian-American orbital flight in 1975. You'll note that all these projects, with very few exceptions when you get down to detail, are inward-looking. That change in NASA policy mirrors what's happened in American society. A preoccupation with the student protesters, civil rights, poverty, the war, and the economy. Nobody wants to spend money anymore unless there's a quick and predictable return in it for America. And yet, the annual cost of the lunar missions was less than American women spend every year on lipstick. To those of us on the fringe, the change has been almost astonishing. To understand it, you have to go back 13 years to the Mercury program and to a team of newly selected astronauts who were later to become known as the Seven. In the early hours of the morning of May the 5th, 1961, an air-conditioned truck brought the first of America's new heroes, Alan B. Shepard Jr., out to his rocket. 1 year behind schedule, and 23 days too late to be the first man in space. Later, he was back after a perfect flight. Only one system had failed to operate, a light bulb. The Mercury capsule was a success. The Americans had their spaceship.
Here he comes.
2 months later, Virgil Grissom might have thought it a better submarine. He'd had to jump as his spaceship sank like a stone. Still, it had worked in space, and in February 62, John Glenn was ready to try for an orbital flight on board a bigger and better rocket, or, as he put it, something that had been built by the company who could do it cheapest.
You are go. Motor systems go. Crate operation go.
You've got speed, John Glenn.
To the watching commentators, this was it. As they saw it, space was the door to the future, and if Glenn made it to orbit, he'd unlock that door.
The speed adjusted now for that keyhole in the sky for orbit.
The nation went wild when he did. First Washington riding in triumph to address a Congress, now more concerned with national prestige than the money it cost. And then a ticker tape welcome in New York. Space was here to stay. We're even giving parades to Scott Carpenter, later fired by NASA for wasting fuel just to watch this sunrise.
I understand the report came from Hawaii that it was a tired and confused astronaut. If my opinion is worth anything to you, this is not true.
Wally Schirra made up for it as he came back from a textbook flight. Drifting and dreaming, he called it, as he circled the world to land within sight of the recovery ship.
At 11:15, the white helmeted aluminum sheet Schirra has emerged back to Earth again.
In May of 63, Gordon Cooper took over from a crippled computer to fly the last Mercury down to the waiting flotilla. Urged on by another Russian success.
This is Radio Moscow. Today at 10:30 a.m. Moscow time, the Soviet Union launched the world's first three-man guided spaceship. The ship was named...
And the Americans hadn't even succeeded in launching a two-man ship. The U.S. space program had had one major success, though, as after six failures, Ranger 7 took pictures right up to impact on the moon. Then in November, the great space enthusiast LBJ, the man who'd done so much for Houston, was re-elected president. It looked like it was go for NASA, the great society, and Gemini. These were truly the golden years, the two that followed the first Gemini launch in 65. 2 years in which America saw the temporary realization of all the dreams it ever had. A small band of brave and dedicated men, rising into the sky on glittering and apparently flawless ships, circled the world again and again, each flight more triumphant and successful than the last. These were the years in which the journey to the moon was taken and checked step by step in Earth orbit to see if it could really be done. Gemini 4 proved a man could, if he had to, cross the space between two ships in an emergency and live. Edward White found the experience so exhilarating, he had to be reminded that the experiment was over.
The flight director says, get back in.
No Gemini 5 proved that men could find and come close to another object in space. Gemini 7 waited in orbit, and then, out of the darkness, came Gemini 6. They proved that one day a lunar module could lift off and find its mothership. The man who brought Gemini 8 into rendezvous and dock with the target vehicle was not to do it again until he was coming up from the moon in a lunar module 3 years later. The pilot was Neil Armstrong. Then suddenly a tiny thruster wouldn't shut down, and the Gemini program had its only near disaster. After an emergency splashdown on Gemini 8, Gemini 9 rose to try the docking again. This time, the protective cover over the Agena docking target failed to open. Docking, as pilot Tom Stafford put it, was impossible with an angry alligator. So Gene Cernan carried on the job of finding out just how much work a man could do in space. Had shown how tremendously tiring spacewalking could be. And though docking had failed, the rendezvous sequence leading up to it had been a perfect copy of the maneuver the Apollo mothership would one day have to complete above the surface of the moon. What's more, the capsule had come down into the water on a pinpoint landing inside of the ship. Gemini 11 finally did what the Apollo ships would one day have to do, rendezvous and dock within 2 hours. That's as long as it would take to complete the first lunar orbit after liftoff from the moon. The Earth pictures returned by the last Gemini confirmed the feeling already gaining ground that one great benefit spaceflight would bring was a clear and detailed view of the planet's rapidly dwindling natural resources. Flew docked to the Agena, Buzz Aldrin spacewalked. Working outside the ship proved once again to be unbelievably strenuous and fatiguing. In November 66, when the last Gemini came home to splashdown, the mood in NASA was euphoric. 10 flights in 2 years, and not a serious failure among them. The early days of humiliation by the Russians were a bad dream.
200 feet.
And at the same time on the moon, Surveyor was beckoning.
13 feet per second speed. Touch. The bus speed report, touchdown.
By the time the automatic orbiters were in action, NASA could actually claim to be looking at last for a landing site. For America, it was unbelievable, like something out of a comic strip. Thank you. 1966 drew to a close, the space program was riding high, perhaps higher than it was ever to be again. The largest structure in the world, the vertical assembly building here behind me, had been put up to house the giant new Saturn moon rocket, and one of them had indeed been successfully flown on an unmanned mission. The new three-man moonship was ready too. It was called Apollo. People and jobs and money poured into Cape Kennedy in preparation for the great adventure. As 1967 dawned, one of the new ships was sitting out on the launch pad ready for the first manned Apollo flight when something happened that nobody could possibly have foreseen. An event from which NASA and the entire space program was never, in one sense, to recover. On January the 27th, 1967, Command Module Pilot Ed White, Spacecraft Commander Virgil Grissom, and Lunar Module Pilot Roger Chaffee took the lift up over 200 feet to enter what was to be the first manned Apollo capsule. By now, pre-launch rehearsals were a familiar thing to the astronauts. They settled into their couches and closed the hatch.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
In a matter of seconds, a capsule was an inferno, charring everything to a cinder. NASA has never released the recordings of what happened inside. The fire was a paralyzing shock to NASA and the aerospace engineers who built the capsule. 1,500 men worked round the clock for 2 months trying to piece together what had happened. The answer was horrifyingly simple: bad workmanship. But in the pre-election confusion, the first Apollo had lifted off to test the mothership and, in the words of one of the crewmen, to give America what it badly needed, a shot in the arm. It's doubtful that Apollo 7 succeeded in that ambition, but what it did achieve was to give back to NASA the confidence that the fire had shaken 2 years before. It proved that the moonship worked, and the way was clear for Apollo 8. And so in December 1968, the team here at Launch Control sent Frank Borman, Jim Lovell, and Bill Anders 250,000 miles across space to give America the best Christmas present it could have wished for. The sound of American voices once again leading the world.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep.
The crew saw what no man had ever seen before. The earth hung like a lovely warm jewel in the freezing, fearful emptiness of outer space. And John Kennedy's promises to land an American on the moon within the decade suddenly looked like being fulfilled. The engine that had to work if they were to return. The world held its breath.
Apollo 8, Houston. Apollo 8, Houston. Apollo 8, Houston. Apollo 8, Houston.
Apollo 8, over.
Hello, Apollo 8. Loud and clear.
Roger. Please be informed there is a Santa Claus.
They'd done it, and the way was clear. In March 69, Apollo 9 was ready to test the last vital piece, the lunar module. The two spacecraft orbited the Earth, docked together, while Dave Scott opened the hatch to let Rusty Schweikert try the emergency procedure of crossing to the lunar module if the tunnel between the two ships ever failed to open. Everything worked.
The things are still falling out up there. What are you doing? Throwing everything overboard?
Well, I'm the camera right here. Taking pictures of anybody taking pictures.
At the end of the exercise, the crew were to close the hatch, climb through into the lunar module, and begin the critical part of the mission, which was to separate the two ships and fly the lunar module through all the phases of a lunar landing, liftoff, and rendezvous. It was during Apollo 9 that the first of the new Earth resources pictures were taken, using special cameras and filters designed to show scientists on Earth details of conditions on the surface, from plant disease to pollution deep below the ocean. Apollo 10, and amazingly, they were on the final rehearsal for the landing three missions earlier than they planned. On May the 22nd, 1969, Tom Stafford and Gene Cernan took the lunar module down to within 60,000 feet of the surface.
We are going, we are down among them, Charlie.
At over 4,000 miles an hour, they photographed the landing sites pinpointed 3 years before by the automatic orbiters. It was here that the only serious failure occurred. The cameras jammed, and Tom Stafford's ripe naval language was never actually broadcast by NASA. And then it was time to fire the engine and come back up.
Okay, we're burning, John. We're burning.
It was this that finally showed America the next flight would be it, as the two spacecraft gently came together 60 miles above the surface of the moon. This was the rendezvous and docking that had never been done out here, so far from home. Jubilant. All the way home, every time there was a television broadcast, they spent their time talking to the children of the world, showing the wonders of their spacecraft, and playing in zero gravity. Back home, the pictures they'd taken were on the front page of every American newspaper. But already the voices of dissent were being heard, as if the public had seen so much of the moon on television and in the newspapers that they got bored. As the summer of 1969 approached, and with it the first lunar landing mission, there was, almost unbelievably, a sense of anticlimax in the air. As if now they'd proved they could land on the next flight, there was little actual interest in doing it. At the same time, the period of high budgetary spending was over. Now was the time, if spaceflight was to become a regular feature of American life, for new and increased funds to be voted by Congress. Well, the money never came. And in towns like this, up and down the coast around Cape Kennedy, people began to think of selling up and moving out as soon as the landing was over. And all across the country, layoffs were happening as the aerospace industries came to the end of the production of these spaceships and rockets. It was at this time that NASA began a really serious public relations attempt to restore public interest. The first lunar samples that would come back were going to answer all the fundamental questions about the origin of the Earth and of the solar system. The missions were no longer being sold as science fiction spectaculars with wide blue yonder jet jockeys rocketing across the void, but as serious science-oriented missions whose returns would bring immediate benefits to the taxpayer back on Earth. And above all, as America's image suffered daily from what was going on in Vietnam, the flights were going to restore international prestige. And as Kennedy had said so long before, arouse a sense of wonder and admiration in the uncommitted nations of the Third World. But the rot had already set in. In a national magazine, even during Apollo 10, there had been a cartoon that epitomized the general sense of apathy. It was of two children watching a shot of Earth from out in space on television and turning to their parents and saying, "We've seen this one before, let's switch channels." But in spite of all, on July the 16th, 1969, when Apollo 11 lifted off the pad, the sheer wonder of what was happening, man on his way for the first time in history to set foot on another planet, wiped out for one brief moment all but heartfelt support for the three men rising into the sky. And the cry from millions of throats that rose with them that day here at Cape Kennedy took the form of one word, shouted over and over and over again, "Go."
Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
A typically beautiful Saturn V launch. looking good, over. Roger, copy. Eagle Houston, yaw around, angle, S-band pitch, minus iron, yaw, plus 1-8. Roger, you're a go to, you're go to continue power descent. You're a go to continue power descent.
Altitude now 21,000 feet, still looking very good. Velocity down now to 1,200 feet per second.
You're looking great, Eagle. What was the reading on the 1202 program alarm? Roger, we got you. We're going at alarm.
That alarm they're talking about means that the computer's overloaded.
Everything looking good. Altitude 4,200.
Houston, you're a go for landing, over.
I understand, go for landing. 3,000 feet. Altitude 1600. 1400 feet, still looking very good.
700 feet, 21 down, 33 degrees. 100 feet down at 19. 1201. 1201. Rocket 1201 alarm.
The same alarm again.
We're go, same time, we're go.
Altitude, velocity light. AAS down, 320 feet. 15 forward. Rocket forward, coming down nicely, 200 feet. 4.5 down. 5.5
minutes.
60 seconds.
1 minute of fuel left now.
Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. 20 feet down 2.5. Picking up some dust. 4 forward. 4 forward. Drifting to the right level. Contact light. Okay, engine stop.
Houston, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
Okay. I'm at the foot of the ladder. The limb footbeds are only depressed in the surface about 1 or 2 inches, although the surface appears to be very, very fine-grained as you get close to it. It's almost like a powder. I'm going to step off the limb now. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
And so, at last, it had happened. But less than an hour later, it was clear that though the tremendous engineering feat of getting them there had been accomplished, perhaps the scientific returns weren't going to be all the public hoped for. Gene Shoemaker, the man who planned much of the exploration, was watching at the time.
Yes, I was there at Apollo 11. In fact, I was in the scientist's back room at Houston during the mission and was able to see both sides of the problem. And there was a genuine misunderstanding between NASA and the public, I think, on one side, and the scientists on the other. There was a widespread belief that one could go to a planet, take a few samples, a few measurements, and come home with all the answers. Very few scientists thought that would be the case. There was only one possibility, in fact, that could be the case, and that is if the moon turned out to be a very simple object, like some of the meteorites that we know. If it had been one big meteorite, indeed, we might have gotten the answer in one mission, but the chances of that were small. We knew enough about the moon to know that it was a complicated place, that it would take many missions, sophisticated missions, and sophisticated men on the moon to get the answers. So in that sense, Apollo 11 perhaps led to a disappointment. But on the other hand, to the scientists, it was not a disappointment. While it's true that only a minimal amount of science was done on that mission, the rocks brought back were tremendously exciting. It's a pity, in a way, that Armstrong, Neil Armstrong, the first man to set foot on the moon, had so little time while he was there. In fact, very few people know that we almost had no scientific part of the mission at all, and that only a very small amount was possible in the first landing. Well, of course, we had to pay our due to history with Apollo 11. It was an engineering flight to demonstrate that we could put a man on the moon. And in addition to that, because it was the first, There was much time spent in the raising of the flag and the speeches from the president, and the clock was running out on us. There were many scientists worrying whether we would get samples back at all, other than a very small bag, which was taken right at the beginning. As it turned out, we ended up with about 7 or 8 minutes, during which Armstrong and Aldrin moved very quickly about the moon, taking pictures, taking samples, but no opportunity to do the relationship, to study the relationship and document the relationship of these samples to the sites from which they were taken.
Perhaps because the general public thought that Apollo 11 had solved all the problems, that the sense of euphoria dissipated as quickly as it did, to be replaced by the feeling of, well, we've done it now, let's forget it. And when the news began to leak out of NASA that 11 had been little more than a hit-and-run affair, the anti-moon faction grew even stronger. As for the uncommitted third world, well, all they saw was a lot of money being spent and none of it going their way. For the first time outside America, people began to ask if it was right that so much money was being spent. And this in turn may have had an effect on the government in America. It was as if the country woke up after the flight to discover that not only had it not solved any of the scientific problems, but that nothing it had done had solved any of the domestic ones either.
Meanwhile, Apollo 12 was snipping bits off the Surveyor probe, having landed dead on target, proving that NASA could now aim for very specific landing sites in future. The pieces of Surveyor would show what 2.5 years on the moon had done to it. All in all, the mission was described at the time as a scientific gold mine. But if the scientists were happier, the public was not. And NASA's public relations were dealt a devastating blow when Al Bean pointed the television camera directly at the sun. Result? Total loss of picture and of taxpayer interest.
Affirmative, we're proud of what you're doing.
By April 1970 and Apollo 13, public interest was dead. Not one American television station showed this broadcast from the capsule as they headed out for the moon, forgotten by everybody but Mission Control. Until suddenly, just after the end of the broadcast, the spacecraft blew up.
Thirteen, we've got one more item for you when you get a chance. We'd like you to stir up your cryo tanks.
Okay. Stand by. Okay,
Houston,
we've had a problem here.
This is Houston. Say again, please.
Houston, we've had a problem. Had a main B bus undervolt.
Roger, main B undervolt. Okay, stand by, 13. We're looking at it.
And we had a pretty large bang associated with the caution and warning there.
We're reading 0 N2 pressure in fuel cell 1 and 13 PSI on fuel cell 3 O2 pressure.
We are banging something out into space.
Okay, let's everybody think of the kind of things we'd be betting. GNC, you got anything that looks abnormal in your system?
Negative light.
Okay, now let's everybody keep cool. We got limbs still attached. Let's make sure we don't blow the whole mission.
Flight, I've got a feeling we've lost 2 fuel cells. I hate to put it that way, but it doesn't all tag up.
Network from flight.
Flight network.
Bring me up another computer in the RTCC, will you?
We got one machine on the RTCC, and we got dual CPs now, see?
Okay, I want another machine up in the RTCC, and I want a bunch of guys capable of running D-logs down there.
Roger that.
Flight Econ.
Go ahead, Econ.
The pressure in O2 tank 1 is all the way down to 297. We better think about getting in the LEM. We're using the LEM systems.
Tell them you from flight.
Go ahead, Mike.
I want you to get some guys figuring out minimum power in the LEM to sustain life.
The near tragedy hit the front pages of every newspaper in the world. In America, space was news again, and the whole country watched and listened. When the explosion had happened, the flight was on course for a landing. Now they had to fire the lunar module's single engine successfully to come home at all.
Jim, you are go for the burn. Go for the burn.
Roger, go for the burn.
Guidance okay?
We're good, flight.
Control? Okay.
We're okay, flight.
Tell me it.
We're go, flight.
Inco okay?
We're good, flight.
Ground confirms ignition.
We're burning 40%. Shut down.
Roger, shut down.
The problem now was to stay alive, and that depended on two things, electrical power and oxygen, what NASA men call consumables. The spacecraft commander, Jim Lovell.
There were moments when I didn't know how much consumables we had, whether we could make it back or not, but in a situation like that, there's only one thing you can do. You just keep going.
There were times, of course, when we
we were sort of praying that everything would work out okay. We did not have redundancy any longer. We had to go over a series of milestones to get back. Each particular burn of the engine or alignment was necessary to get back home safely.
At LOS, loss of signal on entering the Earth's atmosphere, nobody knew if the capsule's damaged heat shield would survive the test.
Okay, LOS in a minute or a minute and a half, an entry attitude we'd like on the Charlie, and welcome home.
Thank you.
The minutes that followed loss of signal were the longest in the space program's history. If the heat shield failed, the crew would die, burned up by the heat of re-entry. But even before they hit the water, NASA had lost the public again on Apollo 14. Their landing site in Fra Mauro was what Apollo 13 had never made, as Shepard stepped out, the oldest and richest man on the moon. To give him his due, he did bring back a lot of rocks, in spite of continuous trouble with equipment that wouldn't work, and a schedule through two moonwalks that had to be curtailed because both men drove themselves to exhaustion. Once again, however, public interest in America was low. There was nothing to watch, except when they were back near the camera by the lunar module, playing golf. That may have been the only good shot of the mission. The other photographic variety lay forgotten in film cassettes, somewhere down there in the blowing lunar dust. That was to be the signature tune of the next mission, Apollo 15, a happier and extraordinarily successful mission, ranging far and wide across the plains between Hadley Canyon and the Apennine Mountains on the lunar rover, after a pinpoint landing right over a 15,000-foot peak that towered evocatively in the TV pictures from the new camera mounted on the rover. Everywhere they went, so did the television audience, watching everything they did. On the first moon drive, they moved only 300 or 400 feet from the lunar module to lay out the Apollo Lunar Surface Experiment Package, the fourth package of experiments to be taken to the moon. Perhaps the most important was the heat flow experiment.
Okay, heat flow is connected.
Roger, we got it.
The heat flow being measured for the first time was that from deep in the moon's interior out to the surface. Vital data in deciding whether or not the moon had a molten core.
Very fine.
Once again, a device for sensing moonquakes was deployed to add to the network already on the surface. Now there were three, quakes could be pinpointed with extreme accuracy. All the experiments worked as usual through a central station relaying data back to Earth. A magnetometer was set up to measure the strength of the magnetic field close to and within the lunar surface. Information like this aids in finding out what the rocks are made of, since material and magnetism are related.
Right between 2 and 3 on the index.
Among the other experiments, one measured the amount and strength of the lunar atmosphere, and a reflector placed in the dust was to become the target for laser beams from Earth, measuring the exact distance between the two planets. Sometimes during the work, though, things did get a little less than scientific. After a few hours' sleep back in the lunar module, the second drive took them along past the breathtaking Hadley Rill, the 1,000-foot deep canyon, to the foothills of the mountains beyond. They loaded up the rover for the last drive, right out 4 miles to the very lip of the canyon. And there, Dave Scott took this photograph of the far side, revealing the strange stratification layers that were to delight geologists for months afterwards. 60 miles above in the command module, Al Worden was doing just as well. Flying a spacecraft carrying for the first time an experiment bay, he was shooting pictures of every inch of the lunar surface beneath his orbit while automatic sensors analyzed the soil down there and searched for evidence of a lunar atmosphere and a planetary magnetic field. This view of Taurus Littro and what looked like extinct volcanoes decided 17's landing site. Back on the surface, Dave Scott was to make the most exciting discovery of all.
I think we found what we came for.
The Genesis Rock, thought for a while to be the oldest yet found.
I'm very proud to have the opportunity here to play.
Then it was all over but for the fun and games, stamping the first lunar postmark on letters, and what came to be known afterwards as the Galileo experiment.
Well, in my left hand I have a feather, in my right hand a hammer. And I guess one of the reasons we got here today was because of a gentleman named Galileo a long time ago, and I'll drop the two of them here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that?
Then came liftoff, watched by millions on the Lunar Rover TV camera parked well away from the blast. And what a liftoff it was. Music from the spacecraft may have shown NASA was having fun, but they were about the only ones. Even though their budget was small now, at least they had it to spend.
You do have a go for another try here at PDI on Rev 16.
April 1972 and Apollo 16.
Looks like we're going to be able to make it, John. There's not too many blocks up there.
The landing and Descartes was a triumph, and outside mission control, nobody cared anymore.
There comes the shadow. Okay, down at 3, 50 feet, down at 4. Give me one quick up. Backing up slightly. Okay, 2 down. Stand by for contact. I'm going to let her down. You level off. Let her on down. Okay, 76%, 20 feet. Contact. Stop.
NASA was really jumping during these last scientific missions. When John Young snapped the heat flow cable, they even thought about trying to fix it there and then.
You know, it looks, I bet it's just like the side of that fresh crater we saw back near the land.
Charlie,
what?
Something happened here.
What happened?
I don't know. Here's a line that pulled loose.
Uh-oh.
What line is it?
That's the heat flow. Pulled it off.
The pity was that missions like these would once perhaps have kept America's interest, especially sharp TV pictures, a lively crew, and more data coming back than scientists could handle. The mission was turning out a brilliant success and setting rock records into the bargain.
Look at the size of that rock!
That big black dot.
If we could see to the bottom, we could say for sure if this big black rock is right out of the bottom.
And as our crew slowly.
Well, Tony, that's your half rock right there.
Yeah, keep going.
That max acceleration? No. Man, you are really fast.
Is he on the ground at all? That's 10 kilometers.
Huh? He's got about 2 wheels on the ground. He's a big rooster tail out of all 4 wheels. And as he turns, he skids the back end to break loose just like on snow. Come on back, John.
Been a mission that raced every step of the way to maximize returns. But as Ken Mattingly went out to get the films he'd been shooting in orbit, time was running out fast for Apollo 16 and for the entire Apollo program. Only one more crew would see this view of the Earth from 50,000 miles out in space on the way home from the moon. Only one more thing occurred to raise the pulse of anybody who was watching. On splashdown, the capsule landed upside down. It was the first time it had happened during Apollo, but nobody was hurt, and back at mission control, as they hit the water, it was cigars as usual.
Oh, no.
John Young even tried an appeal to patriotism. Too late.
You saw an example of goal-oriented teamwork in action. The kind of thing that made this country great, and the kind of thing that's going to keep it that way.
Yes, sir.
Russians were ready to cooperate. And the reason lay in what happened to this flight, the mission of Soyuz 11. The crew were in space to check out for the second time what life would be like here in the orbiting space station called Salyut, the first of its kind. The USSR had long been preparing for this day. They tried and failed to build a moon rocket and had concentrated instead on Earth orbital missions. Salyut was perhaps to be the forerunner of a bigger space station, and these cosmonauts were here to find out what long flights would do to the human body. As the crew made the final preparations to undock and come home, everything had gone beautifully. Both they and their flight directors on the ground were excited, and everybody was looking forward to analysis of the flight after the mission. The Russian tracking stations heard them begin their re-entry, and then nothing. Before re-entry, a faulty door seal had opened, the spacecraft depressurized, and all three had died instantly. The accident brought home to the Russians the vulnerability of their cosmonauts, and when the Americans approached them in early 71 with ideas of cooperation, they jumped at it. What had once been unthinkable was happening. There were Americans drinking vodka in Astrograd, and Russians eating hamburgers in Houston, and everybody was flying everybody else's simulators. Space was turning out to be just too expensive to do it yourself. This was what the fuss was all about, a new docking system that would allow an Apollo and a Soyuz to rescue one another in space. An airlock tunnel between the two spacecraft would allow crews to crawl through from a crippled ship and come home alive. On July the 15th, 1975, a joint Apollo-Soyuz rendezvous will do this in space.
As for the future of lunar exploration, well, nobody knows. At least nobody knows for sure. What is certain, though, is that even if America changed its mind, the rocket and spaceship production lines are virtually closed down. They couldn't go back to the moon now, even if they had the money. Recently in Houston, I asked Jim Lovell if this meant the end of lunar exploration for some time to come.
Yes, I believe so. We perhaps won't go back to the moon, at least until the end of the century. I suspect so. And unless we suddenly increase our capability and launch from some space station.
It does seem strange, though, that after so few flights, that it should all have stopped like that.
Well, we only have so much money. And when we looked at the best place of spending our money towards in our space program, it appears that now it's back to the Earth.
We've been watching Earth, of course, for years through the eyes of dozens of meteorological satellites. Communication and navigation satellites have already brought more immediate benefit, perhaps, than all the lunar missions. But the new infant science that looks like the growth industry of the next decade is Earth Resources Surveying. This computer-enhanced picture of a river delta from space reveals the temperature changes vital to the fishing industry. Same view, this time showing currents and tidal flow deep below the surface. This satellite, launched last July, is already showing how this kind of space technology will help us take the desperately needed measures to clean up the planet and find and conserve what little is left of the Earth's meager natural resources. Carrying instruments to see what no human eye can see, the satellite circles the Earth north to south. Every 18 days, the entire world is scanned in 100 square mile segments that can be put together to give incredibly detailed overviews like this one of Florida. Four pictures of the same scene reveal crop health, evidence of water, minerals, pollution, urban sprawl. Put them together, and a single picture of Washington tells all. California and the diseased crops are obvious to the photo interpreter studying the patchwork of field patterns. part of the Amazon showing only all water in the area. Another shot eliminates all but the clear water. A view of the agricultural activity around New York, San Francisco Bay, and the fog rolling in towards the city. Canadian tundra in the unexplored north. Like many areas, this will be well mapped from now on. A photograph of Greece tells the geologist more than years of work at ground level. And the Grand Bahamas, with the ocean floor showing clearly. The higher you go, the deeper you see. And manned spaceflight? Its fortunes are ebbing fast. Underwater training like this has been going on now for 2 years for the last great all-American spectacular after Apollo, the orbiting space station called Skylab. Due for launch next year, Skylab is really a converted Saturn V third stage with solar panels to convert the sunlight into power, a docking section for spaceships to anchor at, and a solar telescope. Floating over 200 miles up, three ships will visit during the year. Once docked, the astronauts float into the biggest living space likely to be sent into orbit for more than a generation. What they do there is unlikely to attract public attention. Listen to it. Already it's being said, even inside NASA, that Skylab is only going because they had to do something with leftover spaceships and rockets that would cost a lot less than lunar flights. Certainly much of the Earth observation and solar astronomy could be done by automatic probes. There are plans to carry out experiments into the effects of zero gravity on some industrial processes like making ball bearings. But who's going to put a factory up there in the foreseeable future? And as for the long-term effects on man, what man? Beyond Skylab in 1978, the first space shuttle will be coming into land from orbit. For years, NASA has built gigantically expensive rockets and dumped them in the ocean on the way up to orbit. The shuttle won't do that. It'll fly again and again. And this is what it will look like. About the size of a jet airliner, it can take in its cargo bay either 14 passengers or an equivalent in payload like satellites. And NASA is definitely not emphasizing the passengers in its handout. The shuttle will go up to do humble repair work. No more glory, no more talk of man reaching out to the stars. America has done what no one would have believed 3 years ago. She's turned her back on the great adventure. Astrogeologist Gene Shoemaker.
Well, we're stopping in our exploration of the moon, basically because the United States public is tired now of the moon missions. They feel that what was to be done has been done, and there are other more pressing national interests. Of course, for those of us who are deeply involved in the science of the moon, we've only just begun. And what we've learned so far is that the moon is perhaps a unique place in the solar system to go and get certain parts of the historical record about the solar system, in particular about the first billion years history, about the birth of planets, and about other events happening in the vicinity of the sun during these early years, a record that's entirely missing on the Earth. And we are now just seeing the broad outlines of that record. We've learned enough to see the broad picture about the history of bombardment of the moon, about its heating, how it's evolved as a planet. But the most crucial part, which is the first 500 or 600 million years, we really have to go back and we have to explore the highlands in detail to get at. Those of us who thought about this before the missions, before the Apollo ever came into being, thought there was a special role for man. And that role is perhaps best epitomized by the role of the young scientist Darwin, who went on the HMS Beagle on its great classic voyage. And that the thing that made that voyage of the Beagle so important a century ago was the fact that there was that young man who had that ability to observe and discover and to understand the import of his discoveries and to go on from there and make the other key observations that led to a whole new concept that changed our thinking about ourselves, changed the history of thought in Western civilization. We've not put the kind of man on the moon yet. I'm giving him the opportunity to make those kinds of observations. We may have a chance, but it's a slim one now, with the last mission, with one well-trained scientist, the kind of man who can make the observations on the moon, perhaps analogous to those made by Darwin. He's going to have a very limited chance. And it's a long gamble indeed. But that, in the long run, is the only valid reason for sending man out into space, is to make those discoveries, and that's what will make it worthwhile. Make the discoveries that would not have happened if he had not been there himself, instead of just the machine.
Mars may be the furthest we will go in our lifetimes, and then it'll be a machine, not a man, going down to the Martian deserts. And the dream mankind had those few brief years ago, that one day we would gaze on the silent splendor of the outer planets, will remain a dream, at least for those of us alive today. So, as the moment of liftoff here at Launch Pad 39A approaches, those of us who see it will in a sense be closing the pages of the book. Of course it makes sense. The money is needed for far more urgent tasks here on Earth. There are many things that any rational human being would agree have a much higher priority than going to the moon and beyond. But will saving that much money make that much difference? Maybe so. But I wonder if we'd ever know for certain anyway. It's not something that you can work out on a neat balance sheet. One thing we do know, though, unless another reason like national defense or political prestige is ever found, and I doubt that they will be, all we're left with is the thought of where we might have gone and what we might have become out there. And many of us alive today will never know the answer to that question.
That's beautiful. This has got to be one of the most proud moments of my life, I guarantee you.